Hi, Yash, congratulations on your 720, Q50 and V36, right?
Yeah, thanks, Dhananjay.
Okay, how was the feeling after you finished the exam? Because you gave the online exam and I remember how you felt versus when you actually got the score. So tell me both.
So when I just finished my exam, I was thinking that I didn't do very well in verbal. Like GMAT online starts with quant. So when I started quant, I was actually expecting that I will get at least some questions that will be very easy to answer for me. But the average difficulty level was very high. Like I will not say that I was not answering them, but yeah, it was taking good enough time to answer every question. Generally, in every mock test, I used to finish quant with like 10 minutes remaining, 7 minutes remaining, 8 minutes remaining. And my strategy with actual GMAT was also like, I will save 7 to 8 minutes and I will utilize that as a break before starting the verbal. And I was just able to complete my quant on time. I had around 30 seconds left, and then I started my verbal. So before starting the test, I was thinking that I will do quant first. So if there is any test anxiety happening, any shivering or any nervousness, that will happen during quant, and I am anyways good in quant, so that will not impact my score. But with quant, like I was knowing I am getting hard questions, but yeah, I can solve it. Like I was very confident, so I was solving it and moving on. But as soon as I started verbal, I don't know what happened suddenly. Like I was started getting shivering. I became very nervous. I almost drink water, I think 2 or 3 times. I tried taking deep breaths. Like I started taking deep breaths 2, 3 times because I knew like I need to calm myself down, otherwise I will screw it up.
Right. So
But
how did you
like,
focus then? Like, how did you manage to salvage the situation?
Like in the initial 5, 6 questions, I was very like very nervous and very shivering. Then I started I drank some water and then I took some deep breaths, but still it was not working very properly. It was almost like this at least till the 20th question. And after 20th question, I think it like we always say the first 20 questions are important. You need to sail through them, you need to build your capability, and then you just need to maintain it. So after 20th question, I became normal. And yeah, then I was answering and I ended verbal on time. Like there
Right.
was 1 minute left.
Got it. So
So,
very
and in
interesting. Very, very interesting experience, right? So I want to touch upon a few things here. First thing, the complexity of quant questions to begin with. And this is because I've heard from you and a few others as well that they're not as easy as they used to be. So take us through what has changed, in your opinion.
so I think the mocks in which I was taking, like SigmaX mocks and other mocks, basically we have around 10 DS questions or around 15 DS questions. But in GMAT, there were too many DS questions and every question was full of crap. So I knew why they have given this condition. So answer is not going to be C. You can even find just with A. So every question felt like they have set up some trap and like it was definitely difficult to get the questions correct. Like
Got it. Very well said. No, so more DS questions, more traps towards the beginning to make sure that getting a Q50 is hard. So now getting a Q50 is genuinely hard, where we used to take it for granted key the Q50 is something that is easily doable. Now the second piece is that you shivered and verbal was you were jittery across the section. Even that being said, right, you've scored a V36, which is a very, very decent score. What do you think was the most important thing that you did right and versus something that you probably did not do right?
During the entire GMAT journey or just during the test?
Just during the test, and then we're going to go to your GMAT journey as well.
Just during the test, I think if I would have been calm during the test and I would have confidence on myself. So in starting, I got a couple of sentence correction questions, which were like, I have not seen this structure. How can it happen? I have solved like more than 600 questions in SC and I have not seen this kind of structure ever.
So did
So
the
those
meaning-based
couple of
approach help? Did that help over there?
I tried to understand the meaning, but I was not able to understand. The sentence structure was such that there were no ing modifiers, there were not verb ed modifiers. I was unable to understand the structure and the meaning. What's happening here? What is author trying to say? Like, it was complex to understand those questions. I was fairly confident with my CR. CR is something like I read the question, I read the answer choices, I mark it, and I move ahead. Like, it's my like general approach, and it's pretty much logical, and it comes from within. Like, I'm reading something and I will get it. Yeah, author is assuming this is the answer. And the starting couple of CR questions were challenging. I think I did those right, but yeah, they took significant time, they were challenging. And then towards the end, I got certain boldface questions as well. And with boldface, like, we always get a little bit nervous because these are not exactly the logical reasoning through which author is communicating his idea. These are more like, what is a circumstance? What is a fact? What is evidence? When you can change belief, opinion, conclusion.
Yeah.
So that I generally become nervous with the boldface questions, but I think I got them right. With CR, I feel like at least I would have gotten only one or two questions incorrect. Others should have.
Fair enough. I think that's really a good point. And Rajesh just did a webinar yesterday where he was doing two boldface questions, and I saw them and I was wondering, okay, so I don't follow the process Rajesh said, but the idea of what he is saying and then how you take one fact, whether it's a belief, how you see the sentence structure, I think it's very sound, right? So I think all of these things would be inherent in, and you don't even realize it. Whereas for others, it may not be the case. So you cruise through these questions, right? Another piece here is, let's go back to your GMAT journey.
Tarantula, your video is breaking.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
So my point is just one more thing, right? I mean, let's go back to your GMAT journey now. How did you begin studying for the GMAT? What all did you do? And then how did you land up at eGMAT?
So it is a long journey for me, which started in my final year of college.
Please go into detail.
I applied
Please
for
go into ISP. Detail.
Yeah. So I applied for ISP YLP. I got through round one. And then for round two, they asked for the GMAT score and they give 3 months of time. And in my college, like some coaching institute, I will not take the name, but yeah, a coaching institute came and they were offering the GMAT classes. And only 15 classes focused only on verbal. And in verbal also, they were focused only on SC. I attended those classes on weekend. And on weekdays, I was not very serious with the prep, but I used to solve at least 10, 20 questions per day. Like, it was my final semester. I had been placed. So it was a fun time and the time to enjoy the college life. So I was not very serious. What I thought is I will complete the coaching. I will do some kind of practice here. Then I will go to my home and between the time I joined the company, I will get some time. Like, I had around 1 month left before I joined the company. So I thought within that 1 month, I will prepare for it. I will give my GMAT and I will score a good score. Like, till that time, I was thinking GMAT is a joke. Everyone can clear it. It's just the aptitude test. So I was with my mindset. Unfortunately, when I came to home, there were some personal issues going on, so I could not continue with my prep. So at that time, I left. I didn't apply for round two, and I left it. Then I joined the company. Then once you start joining, like, you get so much work, you get involved everywhere, and you kind of start liking the work as well. And you think like you are making an impact, you are doing good there. So just keep working on and keep learning. Then I switched company, I joined Walmart. And then after I again started thinking that let's start again for GMAT. So what I used to do was, there is one Manhattan GMAT SC book. So whenever I used to go to office, my office is in Bangalore. So it's like you take 1 hour to just reach office there. So I used to study that book while I was traveling to office and while coming back. And did nothing else. Then again, so I thought this is also not working out. Let's give one mock. Let's use the GMAT prep one mock. I gave it and I just got a 620. I saw it was Q50 and V24, I think it was.
Yeah, must be a V25, V26. So I'm just going to stop you here. How important was a reality check of that mock? How important do you think it is?
I think super duper important because my perception about GMAT was a random aptitude test that we give for placements, right? And but this is a like a typical tough exam, like it was tough.
Right,
So
so
giving that.
it's not a random aptitude test. Obviously, as Indian students, we have this methodology in our head that, oh my God, it's like the CAT. I just need to give it or pass it to get into a good job or a good school. And I think the GMAT is so much more than that. It teaches you how to manage your work life with studying. I think that's key. It's something that everybody goes through. That should I give it at the end of my college? Now that the college is passed because I had fun there, I just didn't have the time to give it. Can I give it while working? And while working, you may love your job and you may work long hours and you may get no time to study. And you may do patchy study like you did, right? So some from here, some from there. And then you end up either giving the exam or you were smart enough to give a mock and say, let me at least see where I am before I'm, before I go out there and just decide to give it. So very good points. Absolutely good points. So yeah, let's continue the story from after you give the official mock.
Yeah, after I gave the mock, I actually got a lot of work pressure and I had to go to US and Mexico as well for some work-related trips. So I went there. I was only focused on work, like GMAT was not in my mind. Then I came back and this lockdown and this situation happened. So I was stuck in Bangalore for 2 months and then the flights and trains started. So I came back to Jaipur and then I was working from home. So it felt like I'm not doing anything with my life. Like it's just usual schedule of work, 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 and I'm not doing anything else. So and in 2020, it's been a very bad year for me. So
Why
let's
do you
try
say
to do
so?
something
Is this personal stuff or just work related?
personal stuff.
I'm sure. Did you have a bad breakup? Is that it?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, usually when people say this, I'm assuming that is the case. It just comes with experience, I guess. But absolutely understandable. COVID has taken a toll on relationships as well. And even though this is not the right forum to talk about it, it takes a toll on individuals as well. So I mean, in a way, it's good that it gave you more time to prepare for the GMAT.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. So
Yeah,
I'm
it
glad. Yeah,
was
let's
one.
continue the story from there. So COVID, you had more time at hand. What did you do then?
Yeah, then I started. Let's again start preparation. And this time, if I will start, I will not stop. Like, so what I thought is, I will study daily. I will not think about giving GMAT. I will just study till a point I cannot go back. So my strategy was study, study, study. Till the time you feel like you have studied enough, now it will be a very bad decision to stop studying. You will never start again. So that was the phase, like 14 days I was working OG. I was reading different books. I was reading articles on GMAT Club, how to ace SCCR and all. And I was feeling that I'm not being consistent. I'm just giving 1 hour and I'm very casual with my prep. I need to invest in it. If I will invest in it, then only I will become consistent. So that's why I started, okay, let's join some coaching, let's join some online coaching. And I did my good research of 2 3 days on which company to go ahead with. And definitely like eGMAT is one of the best companies to start with. And I onboarded the GMAT online course and then my actual prep started.
Got it. That's a really nice point that you make. Now that when we start preparing, and this is true for every student, by the way, it's always a hodgepodge. I'll do this, I'll do that, and there is no commitment. There's no one giving you data-driven feedback. There's no one giving you a study plan. There's no one giving you feedback on your scores. So it's all you and you assessing that. I'm good at this, I'm good at that, I'm bad at this and I'm bad at that. Most of the times we're not as objective with ourselves as we should be, frankly. I mean, if I were to say that I'm good at XYZ, I may not actually be good at XYZ. But I need someone to, come in and tell me that I'm good at XYZ. So now quick question for you. You did your research. You said you did your research. What is the thing that drove you towards AGMAT? And I'm not looking at you answering from a marketing standpoint, but I want you to tell students on what are the things that you did in your research to find the right course for you.
Yeah, so a couple of points. First was like, I have already read the Manhattan SC book, and I knew by reading I am not going to learn because I had already covered that book and my score was not improving. I was not sure what kind of questions I will get in SC. So I ruled out the approach that I want to buy books and do. And OG, I ruled out in my last year of college because it's like you solve 5 questions, you get 3 correct, you get 2 incorrect. Similar next 5, you get 3 correct, 2 incorrect. But what are you doing? Like, it's like just solving questions. You are not learning anything. You are not even having your error log or things you need to study. So OG, I ruled out at that time. Then I attended a couple of webinars by EGMAT. I gave the first Sigma X mock and I scored a 640 there. And the kind of data that I got after that mock was just like a ESR you get, right? So it was very helpful that
it's actually a little more than the ESR. ESR is you don't get to know the amount of time you're taking per question on questions that you've gotten wrong. So we call it ESR plus analysis. So a good point you made.
Yeah, so definitely a lot of data-driven feedback. Like the portal was very good, the UX and all. I'm a product manager, so I judge every portal with its UX, its features and all. So it was very good. There were a couple of free lessons on VerbID modifiers and all. I took those, like I was able to understand what's going on. I attended some of the questions in Scholarium and it felt pretty good. And definitely GMAT Club was one point where everyone was talking about eGMAT. I read a couple of debriefs. They are also everyone like, just go with eGMAT. It's a no-brainer. So yeah, then then I signed up.
Yeah,
I
then you signed up and then you took the mock, right? That was the first thing that you did. So from the mock, before signing up, right? So once you got to know that I'm at a 640 now, what are the first things that you did? What was the first thing you did?
The first thing was to create a plan, my customized plan, where I added my target as 760. Because till that time also, I was feeling that I can do it. It's just a verbal in which I need to improve. I entered my target as 760. I got my expected GMAT date as 6th December, and which is pretty much close to when I gave the GMAT as well. And it was clear that I needed 2 months of dedicated prep. And then the course itself is very structured. Like you need to start from mastering comprehension. Then you need to go to SC. So I went through mastering comprehension, SC. And I thought that this is the end. Now I can score 90 percentile in SC. I went ahead and just created an ability quiz in Scholarium. And I scored 65 percentile or 63%.
Get that out. You scored a 61%.
I have only given one ability quiz till now in Scholarium, and that was that quiz, 61%. And I wrote to EGMAT support team, okay, that I completed the course and still I didn't got a score. What's happening? Because till now in Indian exams, what happens is that you study, you get a score. You study, you get a score. And that score, like if you have studied well, you will get a good score.
Yeah, so I'm glad you made that point. Now I want to talk a little bit about this because so many people do this, right? I mean, even with our course, even with all the information they have, they study the course. They say, now I've studied the course. Now I'm just going to ace everything. And because the course is that good, it's not that the course is not good. You generally get the feeling that I've done a pre-quiz, I've done a post-quiz, I've understood the concepts, I've made notes, I've bookmarked questions. Now what's left? Well, that is just the beginning, as you would know. It's just the beginning to really using the power of Scholarium. So what did you do after the ability quiz? Once you wrote to us, what did we come back to you?
I got a reply from you, the longest email I think I have ever read. It was a very long and a very useful email. It had 7 to 8 videos, which told me that, dude, you are doing everything in a wrong way. This is not the right way to approach. And after taking the subscription, there is a method to use that platform and to use that course. you need to do cementing quizzes. I was not even knowing what cementing quizzes before you sent me that email. You need to take medium cementing quizzes. You need to take hard cementing quizzes. You need to cement that concepts. Then you need to do test readiness. And then you need to move to mocks. So I kind of skipped all of this. And I was thinking that just by completing course, I will do it. But yeah, then I know like it's more than just doing the course. Yeah. Then I followed absolutely whatever you used to tell me. After that first email, like, I was literally very surprised. And to be honest, like, I appreciate your dedication. Like, I was not expecting that you will help me this much, but thanks for sending that first email. With that first email, I also got the confidence that, yeah, like, I have someone who can help me out in this prep. So now I know that if I get stuck anywhere, I have someone to reach out to. So then I think I have a long list of email chains going back and forth between me and you, and sometimes Archit also reverted.
Yeah.
So whenever I feel like nothing is improving, nothing is happening, I just used to describe what I did. These are my scores.
And I think that's the important piece, right? That you got back to us and said, this is not working. Tell me how I can fix it. A lot of people don't do that. They just randomly go on solving questions and don't follow the method, right? That's one piece. The other piece is that you read my email. Now, that email is created specifically for students who have high potential but don't really know how to optimize using the course. So as a person who looks at the product very closely, which I do, right, I want to make sure that you're getting the best out of the course as possible, whether that comes from support, that comes from the product itself. Ideally, it should come from the product, which exactly is something we're working on. But then I created these email templates with the videos that are just small snippets. You don't want to go through an hour long video to tell you what to do, because you're not going to go through that. Let's face it. So I wanted to create these small snippets for you to understand how to use the course. Simple, how to use the course, do things the right way, stuff like that. So I'm assuming that you read it. A lot of people don't read it. That shows a lot of diligence. It shows a lot of consistency in the person itself. So it goes to show that kind of quality about you as well. About the last piece, about me helping you. I think, yeah, I mean, when someone writes a support, they come back to us for feedback and they need that help. But there are certain students that I like working with because, one, your diligence, two, you're on the right path. And that's very, very important, right? I think you reached out to me, you said, I've taken a mock, I've got this score. So talk to me a little bit about what happened towards the end also now.
Yeah, so I did the prep. It was almost like 1.5 months. I completed the course, did the cementing and everything. Then I gave my second Sigma X mock and I scored a 750. I was very happy. I thought like, let's think about booking the GMAT date, and it's done. And then we got on a call where you analyzed my 750 mock and you clearly told me you are not going to get 750 in the actual GMAT. Like, you are not at V42, it's somewhere around V38, V39. So that was like, okay,
I'm shameless that way. Like, people hate when you know, I say this to them, but whenever I get in calls with people and I say that, listen, that's an inflated score, I'm so sorry, but this is not true. A lot of people can't fathom that information as well. But it comes with just data-driven feedback, frankly. I'm making these decisions based on data and obviously experience. There's a lot of that human element to understand how people think and how people work towards the end of the exam, because I've also given it. I also know exactly what people do. So, that is very important. And I think that feedback at the right point that, listen, 750 is a great score and you're definitely at a 720, you know, but you need to work on these few things. So what are the things that you worked on? And I shared that plan with you. So talk a little bit about that piece as well.
Yeah, so it was clear from the mock analysis, like you told me, that I am not managing my time properly. There are weaknesses in SC. RC, particularly in that mock, the kind of passages I got were very natural to me. So I only got one question.
Yeah, you were not sure yourself. You were like, everything was so perfect, this is not possible only. Which is true, by the way. Which is true. The GMAT doesn't work like that. I mean, you always see a passage that you don't know. So, I mean, again, good on you that you figured that out. That helped me as well.
Yeah, then you created a customized plan for me, like take these quizzes with this much amount of time and these many questions from each section. And I kept working on that. And then I gave a couple of mocks again. The third
What
mock
was
I
your
got
next mock score?
7-10.
Yeah, so I mean, that's the thing, right? I mean, for me, it's very important to see progress. And some people may think that 750 to 710 is not progress. But I'm sorry, that is a lot of progress. You're getting a score that you'll actually get on the GMAT as well, right? And that's when you asked me the question, should I book my GMAT date or not? So, what did I do to convince you to book the GMAT date?
So you clearly told that you will take 8 to 10 days, but yeah, you can do it. And I was also like confident ki, okay, I am now getting everything, like I know how to solve the questions. If I will put some more efforts, revise my error log again, I can do it within next 8 to 10 days. And it's been like a 3 months long journey. So like do it now.
Yeah, so it's important to peak at the right time. And you were going to peak in 10 days, but not in a week like you wanted to give the exam. And I was like, hang on, just hold your horses. But yeah, I'm glad that we did that. And then you fixed the issues that you had and you scored. I think your next mock score was a 740, right?
7:40.
So I think that gave me the belief that, yeah, that's doable because we worked on those things. We worked on those areas of time management. And with time management is about balance. It's about balancing what is best for you, what works for you. So, for example, you were really strong with CR, right? You can save time there and use it in SE. A lot of people are strong in SE and they can use it in CR and RC. So I mean, that balance only comes with fine-tuning your. I can, it's synonymous to tuning an engine. I don't know if you know how to tune an engine, but there are so many tweaks that you have to do to the intake manifold and the cylinders to get that right combination, which is why Ferrari engines or Mercedes engines work so much better than Maruti Suzuki. I mean the engine is also different, but then if you take the same engine, a Mercedes engine, same engine, same spec, and a Maruti Suzuki engine, same spec, a Mercedes engine will be churning out 4x, right? So I mean, there's a difference there. You've got to fine tune those skills for the GMAT. Okay, now that we've discussed all of this, you finally reached, you got your 720. Even after the test did not go as well as planned, right? So, in that moment, what were your feelings? Because I know I have a feeling, but I want you to come out and tell me what you felt when you saw the 720.
Considering my test experience, I was happy that I got a 720, but considering that I at least need a 730 or a 740, I was like, yaar, thoda sa reh gaya. And now 720 is a little bit on the border that you cannot convince yourself truly that you want to do a retake, and you are not even convinced that
Yeah,
like it.
yeah. So I understand. It's a very, very difficult emotion. It's like, man, I've achieved something and I've yet not achieved it. It's so painful. It is so hard, especially for probably your cohort where you need 740, right? Because 720, by the way, fantastic score. It's 94th percentile. That basically means that just about 7,500 people get it in a year of out of 250,000. So calculation wise, you've done a great job, by the way. But have you done a good enough job? I think that comes into the next piece of our conversation, which is admissions and how you decide which college to go to given your score now, right? So the first piece is now that you have the score, you need to focus on your applications. Focusing on a retake will take away a lot of time from actually applying, and you need the time to apply, right? So what are the schools that are in your mind now given the score? Do you plan to go back to ISB? Because you can easily get into ISB
So
with score.
after score, I did not consider which schools I should apply to, but before getting ISB, no. But yeah, INSEAD, probably Kellogg, Wharton, and all are too ambitious now. But INSEAD or LBS.
I think NCR is a very good option for you. You may have about a year, year and a half less work experience, and you're hitting the lower end of their median score for your cohort, right? So are you an engineer?
Yeah.
Yeah, so our cohort is, I mean, for NCR is somewhere around 730, 740, right? That's a safe score to apply to, right? But given the score and given the fact that you have international work ex, you've gone to the US, you've gone to Mexico, and you've worked in these spaces, that makes your profile more valuable to an international business school like NCR, who emphasize a lot. They genuinely emphasize a lot on international work ex. But bear in mind, they have 7 essays, and you need to be really, really careful with what you write in them. And what needs to come out from them. So NCR, definitely do give that a try. It may be a REIT school for you. It may not be a very doable school. But yeah, given your work experience, I would definitely tell you to apply to at least one REIT school. We should always apply to one REIT school when you're applying. And focus more on the things that you've done, right? So for example, a lot of people think that I have volunteering experience, whether that's in school or so on and so forth. Now, what they don't understand is that what B schools really want to know is that, do you have a life outside of work? And do you display the same leadership qualities that you display at work, since you're already applying with a great profile, you'll all be showing the best parts of your work. Do you apply this to your life outside work? And why is this important? Let's understand that as well. It's important because in the MBA community, more than academics, you will be networking, you will be outreaching to people from different nationalities, ethnicities, and demographies. So it's very important to show leadership outside of your comfort zone, I think. And that's something that you need to display. And I think you mentioned in your email to me that you have work experience with Bhumin School, right? So let's take that as an example. Now, that work ex was in school, right? Now, you may use that work experience as in one of your essays as a really as a tool that shaped you as an individual, which is very, very important as well. But it's from a time that's really way back. So it's not something that you've done right now. They want to see what you've done in the last 4 or 5 years. Something very recent, because they're taking you now, right? So that's very key. So I'm sure you have questions around this, and go ahead and ask whatever you want.
Yeah, like with Bhumi, I'm still a volunteer, so it's a volunteering experience where we work on weekends to teach students science of 6th, 7th, 8th standard. And during my college time, like I was involved in a lot of campus groups and cultural and technical fests, and I had a decent enough CGPA
So
in college wise
the
also,
question is,
like.
in Bhumi, now that you've worked with them for such a long period of time, have you grown from your role then to your role now? Has that changed, or are you still just doing it on the weekends and teaching students?
Sorry, can you repeat?
Yeah. Let me repeat. So Bhumi in school to now Bhumi, I mean, you're still doing that, and that's great, by the way. That's a very big factor that you followed up on what you started. But has your role grown into a more leadership like role from when you started off, or is it just
No.
volunteering?
It's just volunteering.
But now that is what makes a difference. So that's what they want to see, that can you transform something that you do on a daily basis into leadership? That's what MBA is about, right? I mean, even at your job, you started off from an export, you go into leadership roles, and that's why you're doing an MBA as well. So they want to see stuff like that on your profile. So while being consistently volunteering for a long period of time is great, it's excellent, it may not add a lot of value to your application, which you may think it does, right? Because it makes sense. Now, the plus points for your application are, one, a great school, IIT Roorkee, very well known, good CGPA, academically you've done well in your 10th and 12th. I think that's really good too. So the question that you need to ask now is that now I'm here, you're working with Walmart, right?
Yeah.
So where do you see yourself in 5 years versus what your long-time goals are? And these are the questions that the B-School applications will ask you. So give this a thought. Give this a lot of thinking. And by the way, thinking about this takes months. It's not a joke. A lot of people just say, I want to be a management consultant. I want to be a product manager. But if everybody wants to be that, then your application is no different from the next engineer, right? Because every engineer wants to become a management consultant, apparently. So
that's true.
There you go. I mean, this again, this comes from experience. I've applied, so I know. And obviously, someone should tell you as well. But having said that, I think NCR is a good school. I'll give you a few recommendations as well. If you're looking to apply in Europe, there's a school called ISE. That's a really good school, given your international work experience. HEC Paris is a great school. London Business School is a REACH. It's a REACH school like NCR. If you're looking to apply to the States, maybe UT Austin, if you're looking to become a product manager. So Texas McCombs, a lot of those people go to becoming product managers for Amazon. So, and their average median school, even though it's not a very, very well-known school, is very high for your cohort. It's 720, even for that kind of school in the States. But it's a good course. It's a really, really good course. Canada, you can probably apply to, if you're looking at product, maybe not Ivy or Rotman, because Rotman is finance, Ivy is consulting. But yeah, Canada, you can probably apply to Rotman because it's a more generic course as well. Plus, it's one of the best in Canada. So in the States, per se, I wouldn't say apply to the M7 because this will definitely not, the score will get you filtered out in the first round itself, right? So you don't want to get dinged. But for a school like UCLA Anderson, again, they got a really good product program. Keenan Flagler, again, very, very good example. In fact, a colleague of mine has just gone with a really good scholarship. So look at scholarships, look at the right schools for you at this score point. So data point is 720. Your cohort is engineering, mail, general, as always. So see what score you require and then obviously go on and apply. So again, we will be connecting for this in the future as well. I just wanted to congratulate you again. This was a really nice interview, and I wish you all the best.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Dhananjay. Thanks for all your help.